Dear students, today we will discuss about aluminosilicates in this lecture. We will discuss about their classification, what is their composition, and their uses and characterization methods. How we can characterize these aluminosilicates. So, aluminosilicates are actually the minerals containing silicon and aluminium along with oxygen, and there are some counter cations to balance the charge on the oxygen atoms of these tetrahedra, silicon tetrahedra, and sometimes the tetrahedra or octahedra of this aluminium. So these counter cations, they overall generates electrical neutrality in the aluminosilicates. Aluminosilicates, like silicates, they are also the part of silicate. We have already studied the classification of silicates, where we have studied that phyllosilicates and tectosilicates are the actually they are the examples of aluminosilicates. So these are abundant and common on the earth crust because they are made up of silicon and aluminium mainly, and these are the abundant elements on the earth. Aluminosilicates, they are of two types, phyllosilicates and tectosilicates. Phyllosilicates means they are sheet silicates, and they are also called as two-dimensional silicates, while tectosilicates, they are 3D or three-dimensional silicates, where all the four oxygen atoms, they are shared in between the tetrahedra, and in case of phyllosilicates, three oxygen atoms, they are shared in between the tetrahedra. Now, first we will talk about the phyllosilicates. Generally, they include the clay minerals. Clay mineral is the major class of the compounds that comes under the category phyllosilicates. They are sheet silicates. The examples of clay minerals are kaolinite is the clay. Then the other the types of clays are that vermiculite and smictite, and in smictite the clay is montmorillonite. In these phyllosilicates, mica and talc and chlorite, they are also under this category. Besides clay minerals, mica, talc and chlorites, they also included in the phyllosilicates. In these phyllosilicates, the three oxygen atoms shared between the tetrahedra. I have already told you, due to the sheet structure, all the three out of the four oxygen atoms of the tetrahedra, the three oxygen atoms, they shared between the tetrahedra. They have good cleavage tendency. So these phyllosilicates have good cleavage tendency. Why? Because they have layered or sheet structure, so that they can cleave along the layers. Then basic structural unit of phyllosilicates is Si2O52 negative, which we have already discussed in the silicates lecture. Then it contains sometimes OH minus. Most of the phyllosilicates, they contain OH minus at the center of six membered ring and forms Si2O5OH3 negative. One charge from this OH, you will find that actually the six membered ring will be formed by the aluminium, and with the aluminium you will find the presence of OH minus. So most of the phyllosilicates, they have OH minus in the at the center of the six membered aluminium oxide. Okay, and it will form this kind of anion. And to counterbalance these charge, there are some cations. They are also present in the phyllosilicates. The cations like iron, magnesium and aluminium, they are attached to the apical oxygen and OH minus in octahedral coordination. Okay. Actually, the coordination number of these metal cations, that are iron, magnesium, aluminium, their coordination number is 6. As I have told that this OH minus is attached to the center of six-membered ring. The six-membered ring of कैटायंस. सो सिक्स मेंबर रिंग्स ऑफ मे बी ऑफ आयरन, मे बी ऑफ मैग्नीशियम, मे बी ऑफ एल्यूमिनियम. एंड ऑन वन साइड दीज कैटायंस दे आर अटैच टू द एपिकल ऑक्सीजन ऑफ द सिलिकॉन टेट्राहेड्रा एंड the OH minus of the octahedral coordination. So these are having the coordination number of 6, while silicon it is having the coordination number of 4. So these counter cations, they are having the coordination number of 6. So in this figure I have shown you the octahedral layer of these phyllosilicates, where you will find that this may be the cation, may be magnesium, iron or aluminium, and you will find that it is octahedrally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it is octahedrally surrounded by oxygen atom. These are the oxygen atoms of the tetrahedra, silicon tetrahedra, and this is the OH minus ion. So these cations, they are surrounded by apical O of the tetrahedra and OH minus octahedrally. We have told that this is surrounded by 6 atoms. They may be the oxygen atom, they may be the hydroxyl ions. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so that the coordination number of the cation is 6. So octahedral layers, actually they may attach via van der Waals forces. These octahedral layers, or you will find the octahedral or tetrahedral layers, they are joined together through the van der Waals forces. And now we will discuss some of the compounds that fall under the category phyllosilicates. So I will discuss first the clay mineral, that is kaolinite. So this is a clay. Clay is actually the part of the soil that is having the size less than 2 mm. So if it is having size less than 2 mm, then it is a clay particle, and this kaolinite is actually 1:1 type clay mineral, where you will find tetrahedral and octahedral. The tetrahedral and octahedral moieties, they will form the layers or sheet type of structure. Okay, I will show you how. So tetrahedral is of the silicon tetrahedra, and octahedra of the this octahedra is generally of the aluminium. So it is aluminosilicate, tetrahedra of the aluminium, and octahedrally this aluminium is octahedrally arranged, like I have told you just before this kaolinite. So in this, one tetrahedral sheet is attached with the octahedral sheet through the oxygen atoms. So one tetrahedral sheet will attach to the octahedral sheet through the oxygen atoms. Kaolinite rich rocks are kaolin. Okay, they are used to form the china clay. So these are the kaolin rocks which are rich in kaolinite. Kaolinite is soft and white in color. So it is generally used to prepare the china clay related materials. It has very low shrink or swell capacity. So it is generally non-expanding clay. So this kaolinite is used to prepare the bone china cup plates in your houses, so that are made up of actually kaolinite. It is a non-shrink swell capacity clay, non-expanding clay, so it cannot be used for the catalytic purpose. Okay, it has very low cation exchange capacity, that is from 1 to 15 milliequivalent per 100 gram. If we see the formula of kaolinite, then the formula is Al2Si2O5OH4. So you will find aluminium, silicon and hydroxyl ions along with this oxygen atom. So this is the basic structure of kaolinite, where you will find that this is the tetrahedra. Okay, so one oxygen is behind this paper, plane of the paper. This is silicon, and these are the three oxygen atom of this tetrahedra, and the fourth one is behind the plane of the paper, and this is the another tetrahedra, silicon tetrahedra, and these tetrahedra, they are attached to the octahedra. So this is aluminium octahedra, this is aluminium. These are OH minus, and these are the oxygen atoms. So you will find these are the OH minus, and this is the oxygen. So this octahedra is attached to this tetrahedra via these oxygen atom, apical oxygen atom of the tetrahedra, and the other attached ions are OH minus ions, so that the coordination number of this aluminium will be 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So coordination number is 6. So this is tetrahedra, and it is attached to the octahedra. So this is one layer. After this, you will find interlayer space. So this is interlayer space. And after this, again, you will find this is the tetrahedra, and this is the octahedra. So like this, tetrahedra octahedra, then interlayer space, then tetrahedra octahedra, then tetrahedra octahedra, and likewise the sheet structure will generate. So this is called as 1:1 type clay mineral, because one tetrahedra and one octahedra, they are arranged, and they are the repeating units of this kaolinite. Okay, now I will help you in drawing the kaolinite structure. It is very easy. Then we can just first draw two triangles on a line. So these are the tetrahedra. Okay, so this is silicon, this is silicon, and here around the silicon tetrahedrally the oxygen atoms are arranged. So this is oxygen. Now draw a line here, and then draw like this, and this is the center. Okay, so now draw two triangles like this. So this becomes octahedral arrangement. This is OH, this is OH, this is OH, and this is OH, and this is Al3 plus, and these are OH minus. Okay, so this is, this one is the tetrahedra, and this is octahedra of aluminium. So TO, so this is known as TO, and the ratio of tetrahedra and octahedra is 1. So this is 1:1. So now you can prepare another layer. Okay, so this you can now again draw like this, and you will find the second layer. So these are the silicon atoms, and these are the oxygen atoms, these are the tetrahedra, and then you can draw easily the octahedra one. So you can draw like this. So this is the octahedra, these are the OH. Okay, so in this way you will find that this is the interlayer gap, and again this is T and this is O. So this is TO 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 TO. The arrangement will like this, TO TO. So this is a kaolinite clay where you will find 1:1 clay type, where tetrahedra is 1 and oxygen is 1, and then these two layers, they are joined through hydrogen bonding. So they are joined through to the each other through hydrogen bonding, because there is OH and there is O. So they form the OH and H. This is hydrogen bonding, and due to this hydrogen bonding, the kaolinite has sticky nature. So it is sticky in nature because in between the two layers there is hydrogen bonding. So due to this it becomes sticky in nature. It is non-expanded type clay. So it is used to prepare the ceramics, the bone china utensils. So due to the hydrogen bonding in between these two layers, it is sticky in nature. The second phyllosilicate that we study is the talc. So in the talc you will find no aluminium. So in place of aluminium there is magnesium. So magnesium will be arranged in the octahedra manner, and silicon has the tetrahedra layer. And here you will find, due to the presence of this magnesium, TOT layer in the talc is attached to the next TO2 layer via van der Waals forces. So now here the layers are of TOT, tetrahedra, octahedra, tetrahedra. So it is a kind of 2:1 type compound, where you will find 2 tetrahedra and 1 octahedra in one layer. So in this talc you will find that this is the tetrahedra, this is the octahedra, and again these are the tetrahedra. So tetrahedra, octahedra, tetrahedra, and the octahedra, the center is magnesium, and you will find that the decrease in the OH minus, because the joining of this octahedra with these two tetrahedra will takes place via the apical oxygen of this tetrahedra. So the OH from this and this, they removed, and the OH minus will be less in number in case of talc as compared to the kaolinite. Okay, so here you will find the interlayer space in between these two layers. So this is TOT, then interlayer space, then TOT. So it is the TOT layer. Now you will find no free OH minus. This is oxygen, 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 this is oxygen. So no free OH group is present on the surface, so that they cannot attach through each to the each other via hydrogen bonding, but they are attached to each other through the van der Waals forces, because there is no tendency for the hydrogen bonding. Okay, so due to the absence of hydrogen bonding, no OH minus at the surface of these tetrahedra or these layers, it is smooth and free flowing. So you use the powders. So in that powders we generally use this talc, which is free flowing and smooth. It gives the sense of smoothness and free flowing. Why this free flowing nature is due to the absence of OH minus at the surface, and due to which they are joined together via van der Waals forces. Now the most important third kind of phyllosilicate we will study is the montmorillonite. It is a smectite type of clay, and it is also a clay mineral, and it is 2:1 type clay mineral. As we have shown that kaolinite is 1:1 type mineral, but this montmorillonite is 2:1 type of clay mineral. And here you will find the difference from the talc. There is a difference from the talc is that here aluminium is present. In the talc, magnesium is present. In the talc, there is no water molecule in the interlayer space. But in case of montmorillonite, there are the water molecules in between the TOT and the next TOT layers. So this is actually similar to pyrophyllite. But the difference is that in case of montmorillonite, there is the water molecule in between the layers of TOT sheets. But in the pyrophyllite, there are no water molecules in the interlayer space. Okay. In case of talc, there is magnesium, but in case of montmorillonite, there is aluminium. These are the smectite clay, and in the smectite clay, the montmorillonite and bentonite clays, they comes in this class. In case of montmorillonite, also the layers have both the basal layers are oxides. OH minus are present only on the interior. Like talc, you have seen the OH minus were present at the interior due to TOT type layer. Here also, the OH minus, they are present at the interior of the layers. The layers have overall negative charge, which requires counter cation. Why the negative charge? Because oxygen is present at the surface of the layer. That generates the negative charge. So to neutralize this negative charge, counter cations, they are present generally in the in between the layers where the water molecules are present. So the cations like calcium and sodium, they are present in between the layers. So you will find this montmorillonite is a very important clay mineral, and because there is the water molecule in between the interlayers, and these cations, they are also present. So you will find that they are excellent catalysts for organic synthesis. We will discuss their use in the organic synthesis. So you have to remember about the montmorillonite clay mineral, which is 2:1 type, and it is expanded type clay mineral, and at the interlayer there are cations and water molecules. So this is the structure of montmorillonite clay. You will find the tetrahedra, octahedra and tetrahedra. So at the surface of the layers, you will find oxygen atoms. So due to presence of these oxygen atoms, one thing is that there is the van der Waal interaction that is attaching these two layers, and in between these two layers there are water molecule, calcium ions, sodium ions. They are the counter ions which are neutralizing the negative charge of the layer. And this is the open structure where you will find this. These are the tetrahedra. This is the tetrahedra. This is the tetrahedra. This is the tetrahedra. This. So the tetrahedra, they are attached through the sharing of three oxygen atoms. 1, 2, 3. Okay. 1, 2, 3. So sharing of three oxygen atoms is there. So this is the tetrahedral layer. Then you will find this is again the tetrahedral layer. There is a sharing of three oxygen atoms, and this tetrahedral layer, this is attached to the octahedra aluminium layer. So this is Al, this is oxygen, OH and OH. So it is having the coordination number of 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 2 OH, they are at the interior of the layer. So it is octahedral, and this is tetrahedral. Again, it is attached to the tetrahedra through the oxygen atom. So this octahedra is attached to the tetrahedra through these oxygen atoms. So you will find tetrahedra, octahedra and tetrahedra. So two tetrahedra, one octahedra. So it is called as 2:1 type of clay. And TOT like this, then TOT. Again, this there will be interlayer gap, then TOT. So likewise, the layers will be arranged in montmorillonite, and this is a very special clay where you will find the importance of this clay in the organic synthesis. Mica is also under the category of phyllosilicates. They are also having the sheet structure, and the formula is KAl2OH whole twice Si3Al. O10. So here you will find the Al will also form the tetrahedra. One of the silicon tetrahedra will replaced by the aluminium octahedra, aluminium tetrahedra. So if there are four silicon tetrahedra, then one of the tetrahedra is replaced by the aluminium tetrahedra. And due to the presence of this aluminium, one cation is necessary to neutralize the overall molecule. So potassium is present as a counter cation here. It is again a layered or platy texture. Muscovite and phlogopite, they are the examples of mica. One tetrahedral silicon is replaced by tetrahedral aluminium. So extra negative charge is balanced by the potassium. So this is the mica. The second types of these aluminosilicates are tectosilicates, and tectosilicates are the three-dimensional aluminosilicates. These are the three-dimensional silicates, in which all the four oxygen atoms of the silicon tetrahedra they shared by the adjacent tetrahedra. There are various examples of tectosilicates. The one is the feldspars. The general formula of feldspar is MT4O8. T means tetrahedra. So the tetrahedra may be of aluminium or silicon, and the metal may be sodium, potassium, barium or calcium. So four generally four metal cations, they are associated with the feldspars, and they are the main constituents of the igneous rocks. In feldspars, Si4+ means the tetrahedra, the silicon tetrahedra is replaced by the aluminium tetrahedra. Okay, so to neutralize this tetrahedra, the charge, negative charge generated due to this tetrahedra, some cations like potassium, sodium, calcium and barium, they are necessary to balance the charge. So the examples are albite. So the in case of albite, you will find I have shown you the general formula is MT4O8. So T4 means 3 silicon tetrahedra and 1 aluminium tetrahedra. So total 4 tetrahedra are there, and M is the sodium, then it is known as albite. The other feldspars are microcline, where you will find the metal is potassium, and it is just like the formula is just like to that of albite. Then celsian, the barium is the cation, and you will find that because of the replacement of 2 silicon tetrahedra by the 2 aluminium tetrahedra, there is a need of 2 positive ions so that the barium will form the feldspars. Like anorthite also, there are 2 aluminium and 2 silicon tetrahedra, total 4 tetrahedra. So due to replacement of 2 silicon tetrahedra by the aluminium tetrahedra, again it will require 2 positive charge so that the alkaline earth metal like this calcium will form the feldspar like anorthite. So this is about the feldspars, which are the tectosilicates. The other tectosilicates are ultramarines. So ultramarines are generally blue colored pigments. They are prepared from the grinding of lapis lazuli. This lapis lazuli is a blue colored stone, and this will help in synthesizing the blue colored pigment that are known as ultramarines. In these ultramarines, you will find all are having the similar kind of elements except the sulfide, chlorine or sulfate. So these are the different kinds of ultramarines. So this is ultramarine where you will find the sulfide ion. In the sodalite, there are chloride ions, and in the nosylite or nosine, sulfate ions are present, and except these ions, all the elements, they are present in the similar amount. The other kind of tectosilicate is geolite, and geolites we have already studied in one of our lectures, so I am not giving much detail. I will cover only the material that has not been given in the geolites lecture. So in the geolites, they are generally molecular sieves. They are crown jewels of catalysis. They are very good materials for catalysis process. The general formula is this. They show both kind of acidic behavior, Bronsted acid as well as Lewis acid form. So due to their Bronsted acid and Lewis acid behavior, they acts as catalysts. Okay, and acid strength is generally directly proportional to the silicon to aluminium ratio. So as the silicon aluminium ratio increases, the acid strength of the geolites also increase, and due to increase in the acid strength, they are utilized in the reactions where acids are used as the reactions takes place in the presence of acids. Okay, so they are very important. We will discuss about the catalytic process of clays. The catalytic process of the geolites I have discussed in the geolite lecture. If you see their structure, the structure of geolites is channel or cage type. They have cage and channels where the catalytic processes or the other processes they takes place, they have high thermal stability and they can resist the temperature from 600 to 1000 degree centigrade. And how we can synthesize these geolites? So for synthesis of geolites, we require the silicate source, we require the aluminium source, and in presence of ammonium salts or amines of alcohol or alcohols, we can synthesize the geolites at a particular temperature range. So here we have used this Na2SiO3 AlOH whole thrice to form ZSM5 in presence of an ammonium salt, that is CH3CH2CH2N whole 4OH. So this is the simple method of preparation of geolites. Protonation of geolites, dealumination in metal and metal complexes in the geolites are the methods for modifications of geolites structure. So they generally, the processes they can be done after the synthesis of geolites. Then the methods for characterization of geolites, how we can characterize the geolites. There are several methods which are helpful in characterizing or identifying the geolite structure. So the first method is elemental analysis. The what elements are present in the geolites or any aluminosilicates, actually we can say. This can be done with the help of ICPAES, that is inductively coupled plasma atomic emission spectroscopy. Then the other method for elemental analysis is IC, that is ion chromatography. These methods, they are helpful in determination of elements. Either silicon is present or this aluminum is present, which kind of elements they are present in the geolites. Then EDX, this is energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, and XPS, that is X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, that is used to determine the elements present in the geolites. The other methods for the characterization of geolites are X-ray diffraction. In X-ray diffraction, actually the position of each atom in the crystal can be determined. Okay. What is the distance between two atoms, that can be determined with the help of X-ray diffraction. Then Fiji-Jobson analysis, and in this Fiji-Jobson analysis, gases are used, generally nitrogen is used for this kind of study, and with the help of the Fiji-Jobson of these gases, the surface area, the pore size, the pore shape of the geolites can be studied. Then the very important methods for characterization of geolites is electron microscopy, and this electron microscopy is of two types, that is SEM, scanning electron microscopy, and TEM, that is transmission electron microscopy. This scanning electron microscopy, it scans at the surface of the material, so it gives the information regarding the sample surface and its composition. And in case of TEM, the transmitted beam of electrons, it is helpful in determining the structure of geolites. So it gives information regarding the inner structure of the sample, that are crystal structure, stress state, and morphology. So SEM and TEM are very applicable techniques that are useful for characterization of geolites. NMR spectroscopy, that is nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, it generally tells about the chemical environment of the specific element, and for that magic angle spinning is used, that is MAS. So for this, 29Si and 27Al MAS NMR spectra is used for determining the chemical environment of the specific elements, that are silicon and aluminium. Then infrared spectroscopy is also used to characterize the geolites, and it generally helpful in finding the acid sites in the geolites. So the OH attached to the silicon, they can be determined with the help of infrared spectroscopy, because generally they absorb at 3800 to 3500 centimeter inverse. Now we will study about the applications of aluminosilicates, because aluminosilicates are very useful materials. So it is an important part of aluminosilicates that what are their uses and what are the applications of aluminosilicates. So they can be used as adjuvants, they can be used as water softeners, they are used as catalyst in the organic synthesis is very useful. Mechanical and thermal reinforcement due to high surface area is very important. They also act as ion exchangers. They are polymer fillers. Now I will explain you about their uses in different fields. The different aluminosilicates, they are used in the different fields, like medical uses, they have some industrial uses. So I will explain and discuss you one by one. Medical use of aluminosilicates. So they have a lot of medical uses, like magnesium aluminium silicate, that form clay, that is kaolin, is used to treat diarrhea and rashes due to diapers and any other the cause may be any other. So the magnesium aluminium silicates, they are useful to treat diarrhea and rashes. And then they can be used as antacid also, and thickener. So they are used as thickener and antacid for some cosmetic products, which are beauty products. Okay, they are also the inactive ingredients of deodorants. So they are also used in deodorants. They are also used as sensors, filtration membranes, energy storage in the medical field. Industrial uses. So the aluminosilicates like this kyanite synthesize mullite, which is used in ceramic industry as refractory materials. They are also used as insulating materials, because they are not conducting electricity. Feldspars are used for the preparation of glass, ceramic, paint, plastics and rubbers. They are also used in the earth science and archaeology for potassium organ and luminescence dating. Ultramarines are used for as blue pigments in oil-based paints. They are very important pigments. So they are used as blue color to give in the oil paints, in laundry for washing the clothes, use in the makeup accessories like mascara, eyeshadows, and they are also used for the manufacture of papers. Okay, then the clays and geolites, if you will find, they are very good catalysts in organic synthesis. Geolites, they are used for radioactive waste treatment, wastewater treatment, drying agent, ion exchanger, water softener, controlled release of fertilizers, which we have already discussed in the geolites lecture. So these are the different uses of aluminosilicates. Now concluding the lecture, in this lecture we have studied about the aluminosilicates, their classification. They are generally of two types, phyllosilicates and tectosilicates. Phyllosilicates are sheet or two-dimensional aluminosilicates, while tectosilicates are three-dimensional silicates, aluminosilicates. The phyllosilicates, they are containing the clay minerals like kaolinites, montmorillonite, then mica, talc, chlorite are the other examples of phyllosilicates. And in this phyllosilicates, you will find that they may be 1:1 type or 2:1 type clay minerals, or in sometimes in these phyllosilicates, OH minus is also present along with the counter cations to balance or to maintain the electrical neutrality of these phyllosilicates. Okay. Then in among these, the montmorillonite is a very special kind of clay mineral, which is 2:1 type clay mineral, and it is very important in the synthesis of organic compounds. Then tectosilicates. In tectosilicates, they are three-dimensional silicates. We have studied about feldspars, ultramarines. They are very important. Ultramarines are very important coloring pigments. Then geolites. The geolites, they are very important aluminosilicates that are used for the purification of water, for the waste treatment, for the release of fertilizers, etc. And then we have studied about the characterization of geolites. What are the methods? They are elemental analysis, X-ray diffraction, physiosorption analysis, then electron microscopy, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and infrared spectroscopy. These are the methods which can be used for characterizing the geolites. Then we have studied about the applications and uses of aluminous silicates, and mainly they used in the medical field as well as the industrial uses are there of the phyllosilicates and the tectosilicates. Okay, so this is all about the aluminosilicates. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the catalytic properties of the clays. So thank you very much.